Hachette Audio presents Fare Thee Well, the final chapter of the Grateful Dead's long, strange trip. Written by Joel Selvin, with Pamela Turley. Read by John Glouchevitch. Includes a Mac and PC-compatible PDF of photos. Dedication. To Bobby, Phil, Mickey, and Billy, and all the Deadheads. Chapter 1. Board Meeting. Christ, not Garcia. Nobody expected that. True, everybody on the plane had heard him wheezing when he fell asleep on the flight home from the band's last concert at Soldier Field in Chicago. But his death in August 1995 had come as a complete and sudden shock to all his bandmates and their organization. The Deadheads, especially the canny older guard of the band's exceptionally knowing, caring fans, were not so surprised. Many had stopped coming to shows after Garcia returned from his diabetic coma in 1987. They were heartbroken as they watched his waistline explode, his health deteriorate, and his once unparalleled skills on guitar disintegrate. As the band's performances through the 90s continued to devolve, with Garcia's personal problems increasingly apparent and their audiences almost inexplicably still growing beyond imagination, some simply stopped attending, convinced they were watching him kill himself. Just as no other band had ever been like the Grateful Dead, Jerry Garcia had been like no other band leader. He was the philosophical axis, the virtuoso guitar player, the father figure, the best friend. In fact, each one of the four surviving members thought that he alone had been Garcia's best friend. They held no such illusions about each other. Garcia was their true north. Since they were young men, they had set their compasses to him. His death hit them like a sledgehammer. But in the uncertain and bewildering days after Garcia's death, it wasn't just the loss of friendship with him that they had to mourn. Their entire foundation had come loose, and they were jolted by the harsh realities that had suddenly intruded into their lives. Distraught and fearful, uncertain of the future, canceling engagements, laying off loyal crew, these men had barely seen each other since the funeral, couldn't bring themselves to. Each one had largely disappeared into his own world. 4 months went by after Garcia's death before the four surviving members could muster the will to meet and decide what to do about the beast called the Grateful Dead that had ruled their lives for the better part of four decades. After 30 years of touring, the band ached from a deep weariness that almost no one but their road crew could understand. Over the years, they had realized the Grateful Dead was bigger than all of them, had a life of its own, and created its own momentum. But could it survive without the visionary leadership of its founding father? There had been many lean years in the history of the Dead, but by the time of Garcia's death, they were playing to stadiums full of paying customers in every city in the country, and it was hard not to go out and pick up the money. They had come to enjoy the charter jets, limousines, and five-star hotels. Band members, along with crew and staff, were settling down, getting married, raising families, buying expensive homes. Their employees numbered more than 60, many of whom had been on the trip for decades. The band's so-called career was largely an accident. The Grateful Dead never sought success. They saw themselves as musicians. They played music. The actual business of a rock and roll band was a mystery to them, and they couldn't be bothered with it. They didn't think in terms of wealth and fame. They hadn't sought it and didn't know how to value it. Eventually, they realized if they were going to manage their organization and continue to do what they loved, they had to come to terms with the commerce, and they made a grudging, uneasy peace with it. More than any other rock band, the Grateful Dead had enjoyed freedom from highly structured and rigid business practices. Instead of corporate bylaws, they had lived by a code vigilantly observed, which had served to create the Grateful Dead ethos. They had largely been able to approach life on their own terms, but with a level of success they had stumbled into, that carefree attitude was no longer possible. The band members and their most trusted associates showed up on Thursday morning, December 7th, at the band's old Victorian in downtown San Rafael that had served as their headquarters for more than 30 years. The new Novato headquarters on Bel Marin Keys Road was not quite ready. They were there for a meeting of the board of directors of Grateful Dead Productions, the corporate arm of the famed psychedelic rock band. They were weighed down with grief, the burden of having to decide the fate of not only themselves, but of all the people who depended on the organization for their livelihood. Their long-suffering staff stood by anxiously. Drummer Billy Kreutzmann still couldn't bring himself to attend and stayed behind in Hawaii. It would be the last board meeting at the Lincoln Street complex, held in the upstairs room in an auxiliary building across the street from the ramshackle two-story gabled house on the quiet corner. In typical Grateful Dead fashion, the band had rented the building since they first moved to Marin County and had only recently purchased the former Coca-Cola bottling plant in nearby Novato, where the band's thriving merchandise enterprise had already been located under a rental agreement for several years, and where the entire Grateful Dead operation would now be centered. Just before he died, Garcia had visited the new rehearsal hall and offices and given his approval. For the last 10 years, the band had been the leading box office attraction in rock, pulling down a hard-to-believe $370 million in gate receipts over the decade. Now, that roaring river of revenue had come to a sudden and complete halt. The operation was in immediate economic freefall. They had already scrubbed an East Coast tour scheduled to start in September and laid off their 30-person road crew. Between the office and the band's merchandise business, there were still another 30 employees. Like many families protecting an addict in their midst, the Dead had lived in denial over Garcia's health issues. They had survived one near-death episode years before, but carried on while Garcia continued to sink deeper into the abyss. He had struggled for 10 years with his heroin addiction. Only band management knew that he had secretly made plans to enter rehab at the Betty Ford Clinic after Soldier Field that July. The management team had questioned among themselves whether the September tour would happen. Garcia, chafing against the detailed routine, bolted Betty Ford after a few days, but had checked into another treatment facility in Marin County when he was found dead in the middle of the night. With such a large organization, it would make sense that a financial plan would have been in place to cover unexpected catastrophic events, such as the death of the leader. Yet nothing like a plan had ever been developed. The Grateful Dead operated like a minimum wage worker, living paycheck to paycheck, without preparation for the future, acting like things would never change. They had worked for years, but had little to show for it, other than expansive lifestyles and large debts. With a number of Dead employees already gone and more layoffs booming, Garcia's death forced instant hardships on those he left behind. These were mostly people who had labored beside the band for 30 years or more. The egalitarian Dead treated them like family. They paid salaries well above the industry norm and extended all kinds of financial assistance to their people. When a fallen redwood tree crushed manager Cameron Sears' home during a New Year's Eve show while the house was vacant, the band loaned him the money for repairs. The band routinely extended cash advances to crew and employees and then carried the debt on the books for years. Such generosity was typical of the Dead. The type of loyalty the band members showed the people who worked for them was rare in the music industry, and these layoffs cut them to the core. Guitarist Bob Weir and bassist Phil Lesh had attended the first company meeting within 2 weeks of Garcia's death, conducted by band attorney Hal Kant. The first round of layoffs, where anybody who had worked with the band less than 10 years was let go. They hung around after the meeting to commiserate. "This place has been a haven for the chronically unemployed," Weir told the band's computer specialist, Bob Braylove, whose relatively recent hiring meant he did not make the first cut. "You'll be all right." The layoffs only heightened the emotional toll on this traumatized group. There was no consensus on what to do. Weir, along with drummer Mickey Hart, eager to return to performing, had committed to a summer tour to be called the Further Festival, which would feature a repertory-style program that included Hot Tuna, featuring Jefferson Airplane alumni Jorma Kaukonen and Jack Cassidy. The East Los Angeles Chicano rockers Los Lobos, who were a favorite of Garcia's, former Dead Sideman Bruce Hornsby, and others. It was a hurried and unorganized effort to find employment for at least some of the crew and help cover lost income for some of the Dead's concert promoters across the country. Phil Lesh, sick of strenuous touring and father of two young sons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.